is that we are really trying to remember, and the actual fact of the matter is that Jesus is the answer. And when somebody asks, how can I know God, and how will God make himself known to me so I can know him, the answer is in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That is why it's so important to accept Jesus in our life, because that is how to know him. His Spirit in us testifies to the truth, and it's in knowing him that we know God, and that's exactly what Jesus told the Pharisees and stuff. But let's start off with a word of prayer here as we get going here. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word today, and we are so thankful for everything that you're doing in our lives and in this church, and I pray that you would help these people to even have just a greater understanding about what communion is all about and why we do it and what the significance of it. And so, Lord, I pray that you would just touch everybody and open their hearts up and just use your Spirit to go ahead and anoint these words and just help them to just feel you, Lord, and just so they can just feel you in their life and how important it is to know you and see you and have you, Lord. And so we thank you again for this opportunity to share and for all that are here. And we ask for these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So today the title of this message is The Purpose of Communion. And hopefully you'll have your outlines with you today and stuff. So if you forget, you can take them with you and review them a little bit. We're going to be again in Psalm 22. And so this is where I'd like you to have your Bibles open. There's other scriptures that we'll go to, but I'd like you to. We're going to be reading through it here quickly. And I'd like you to be able to see these things. So when you look at it on your own, you'll be able to break some of these things down yourself and review and remember what we talked about today. Today we're going to be participating in the Lord's Supper, and that is after the sermon. And my sermon today is designed to try to help us get a better revelation of what we must remember during our communion service. And communion should help us to remember his death, his resurrection, his holiness, his forgiveness, and also his redeeming grace. And so we must focus and keep focused on the importance that we need to be thankful and for what Jesus has done for us. And so we need to be thinking about these things. Now, the first thing on your outline is what I want you to have and know is that when Jesus hung on the cross, it wasn't the end of life for him, but it was a completion of a divine plan. This is a divine plan of God to do that. Jesus didn't get killed. Jesus let himself go to the cross and be killed. Not be killed, but I mean he died on the cross so he could go and deal with this divine purpose that they had and stuff. Now, this is a holy subject today, and it is what it impacts our life in such a way. And we want to see the significance today, and we're going to be taking a closer look at it exactly as he's going to the cross, because I feel that if we get a better understanding of what Jesus went through for us and what tremendous pain he experienced for us, it'll only give us a greater appreciation for him, and I think it's going to give us a greater desire to serve him. Remember, I've said so many times, we were saved to serve. We weren't saved just be born again and go on our merry way. We are incorporated into the army of God, and there's a purpose and a plan for us, each and every one of us in our life, with a bunch of opportunities that are put before us that we need to exercise and know about it. So today we're going to be in Psalm 22, and it might seem like a curious text to turn to when we're talking about a distinctively New Testament event. And normally I'm looking at the New Testament to find out what's happening in the Old Testament, because the New Testament usually reveals what was going on in the Old Testament. But today we're going to be turning it around and looking at the Old Testament to find out more what was going on in the New Testament. Now, in Psalm 22 is one of the most dramatic and detailed descriptions of what happened when Jesus died on the cross that is ever found in all the scriptures. In fact, in many ways, that Psalm 22 has got more details than the accounts that we find in any of the Gospels about the death of Jesus. Now, this song, and it is a song written of Christ's death, seems like a different kind of song, but yet it is one that is to be set to music, and it is written by David with those instructions. Now, can you imagine how blessed he was to have this future revelation of Christ's death and then put it in a song? Wow, a song with these words inspired by God, obviously, because these came true. They came true. And it's so amazing because Psalm 22 was written and recorded on your outline 1,000 years before the actual crucifixion was taking place. We see that 1,000 years ahead of time, they could see what was going on. Now, the fact is, when these words were written, crucifixion wasn't something that was even practiced in general. The Jews certainly didn't do that. They did stonings, but they didn't do any kind of crucifixions or anything. It was the Romans who picked it up, but they picked it up much later than that. Rome wasn't even in existence at this time, even as a power, I mean, and they picked it up from the Assyrians. Remember the Assyrians much later, who spread it all through the east, and the deal is that the Assyrians believed that no evil spirits could touch the ground, and they would take people that they considered enemies of the state and pin them up all over the place. This is what Jonah saw in the whale when he was told to go preach to the Ninevites. We are Assyrians. And when he went into the town, there were people pinned up all over the place. And it was a horrible sight. And this is one of the reasons that Jonah didn't want to go there and preach to them, because they were so barbaric. It was such a horrible thing. However, his preaching caused a 100-year revival before they fell away and were bad. But he went in there and there were people pinned up all over the place. That was amazing. That this event is described in Psalm 22 when this particular form of execution was not in practice at this time at all. And we are reading a detailed account of today about what happened when Jesus died on the cross. And so it makes me wonder, what did David think when he had this revelation? It must have been incredible to him. He must have just wondered and thought in amazement. Psalm 22 actually records the exact words of what our Lord spoke as he hung on Calvary. And what a mystery it must have been for him. We're going to start reading it right now. I want you to turn with me on Psalm 22, and we're going to read through it, 1 through verse 21. So we're going to read 21 verses. Here we go. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me? And from the words of my roaring, oh my God, I cry in the daytime, thou hearest not. And in the night season, am not silent. Now don't forget, there were 3 hours that were dark when he was there on the cross. But thou art holy, oh thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel, Israel's God. Our fathers trusted in thee, and they trusted, and thou didst deliver them. God is faithful for delivering us in our times of trouble. They cried unto thee, and they were delivered. They trusted in thee, and they were not confounded. But I am a worm, and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out their lip, they shake their head, saying, he trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb, and didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. That means he knew of him even before he was born. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. Now Bashan was just an area near Jerusalem where they had the largest, biggest bulls around. And these bulls represented the Roman soldiers who were strong and powerful. They gaped upon me with their mouths as ravening and a roaring lion. Who's the roaring lion that goes around ready to devour? Satan. Satan is in control of all unsaved people. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. He was poured out like water when he was stabbed, and water and blood came out of him. All of his joint bones are out of joint. When they dropped that cross into the ground, his bones went out of place. when the cross hit the ground and shook his bones out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is said that he was died from a broken heart, and it is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. That's a potsherd is a clay vessel that's all dried up, that when it breaks into a million pieces, because he was thirsty. And my tongue cleaveth to my jaws because he was so thirsty. Thou hast brought me into the dust of death. That's where the Lord goes when he dies. For dogs have compassed me. Dogs are considered Gentiles. The Israelites considered all people that were not Israelites dogs. The assembly of the wicked have closed me. The assembly of the wicked is the Pharisees. The wicked people that were Jews that were had their own religion. They were very religious, but they were not of God. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. I may tell all my bones means he was naked. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. And we know they cast lots for his inner garment. And be not thou far from me, O Lord, whom my strength hath thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog, the Gentiles who do not understand, the unsaved people that would hate the Lord or don't have time for the Lord because they don't have the Spirit in them and they don't understand what this religion and this Christianity is all about. Save me from the lion's mouth, that's Satan, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorn. The unicorn is a wild beast. They had one horn, wild oxens there that had one horn. That's another way of talking about the bulls of Bashan. There we have it, 1 through 21. Now this song starts with the statement on Jesus on the cross, and it is actually the fourth statement from the cross as we start right there. That's the fourth statement on your outline. The first words of Jesus is seen in Luke 23:34, when he prays for his enemies as they hung on the cross, and it was a prayer of forgiveness for the ones who actually carried out this horrendous task of nailing him with spikes through his hands and his feet. It was to the bulls of Bashan who the Lord forgave. They were just soldiers doing their job. They knew no better. They were just taking orders. It was to the Roman soldiers that he cried out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. On the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew 5:44, he tells us just what Jesus did and what he practiced when he said he loved his enemies. And it's what he said in the beginning of his ministry, and he lived that life all the way to the end. Now, these first words reverberated in one of the thieves' heart. And in his rebellion and bitterness and anger that no doubt had driven him all these years, it just immediately dissolved. And when he heard Jesus' words, his heart melted. And however then, his second statement was a word of reassurance to the thief that was crucified on one side of him, to the right side of him. The right side is for the sheep and the left side for the goats. In Luke 23:42, the thief said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. But then Jesus said in verse 43, in his second statement, verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say that today you will be with me in paradise. Paradise was that place in the middle of the earth that was split into two halves. Hades was split up with one side paradise, what we call Abraham's bosom, and the other side was hell. And we see a picture of that in Luke with the rich man and Lazarus. And notice how the thief said, when do you come into your kingdom? Because he did not say, if you come into your kingdom. So it shows that this guy had more insight than most of Jesus' followers. They all deserted him and ran away, not sure what was going on. And this thief, he even defends God in Luke 23:40-41, saying to the other thief, don't you fear God when you're even dying? This is so typical in many churches today that sometimes those who know the most do the least, and those who know the least do the most. For they're inspired being new Christians to share it with others, and old Christians go, too bad for them, I'm saved. And so often old believers, they don't stay in the word religiously, and they lose their enthusiasm. Now here's an example of the mystery of the gospel. I mean, when both thieves hear the same message, and one man will listen with indifference and rejects it, and the other one will have his eyes open to his need for a Savior, and he will believe and be saved. And we see this all around us, that when you give out the gospel word, some people go, oh yeah, and it hits them right in the heart. And other people go, I haven't got time for that. You can have your church stuff. I don't need that. And that's where John 19:26, he said, this third statement is when Jesus was looking down at the foot of the cross, and he looked at the apostle John there with his mother Mary, and that's where in John 19:26, he said, woman, behold your son. And then in verse 27, he said, son, behold your mother. Now, this is not Jesus' biological brother. Jesus had brothers and sisters. And they were gone. They did not believe until Jesus was crucified, until Pentecost did they even believe. And one of his brothers' name was John, but this is not that John. And he was telling John, the only apostle that made it to the cross because the others fled and ran away. He was described as the one that Jesus loved. And he was telling John, the only apostle that made it to the cross, from now on, would you look after Mary? And since Jesus was the oldest son, we know that it was customary for the oldest son to take care of his mother if the dad dies. And of course, who in this case was Joseph, his stepfather. And so we know that he was so close to his mother. Can you imagine how Mary must have felt seeing her wonderful oldest son tortured and nailed to the cross, naked? You know, most parents would rather take the pain themselves rather than let their own child go through it. Now, when he said this third statement, all of a sudden a strange darkness covered over the earth. And it was at 12 o'clock noon when this happened. Now, looking at more evidence, it proves that the truth of this Bible, and we see that many historians at this time had this darkness recorded also. And this gives evidence to this as a global phenomena. It is recorded in the records of Caesar about this darkness, as well as the ancient historian Josephus and many others, which would indicate that it was not just darkness in Jerusalem as Christ was being crucified, but it happened in many other places. It's interesting enough also, the darkness was in the middle of the afternoon when the sun was normally shining, and this darkness lasted from 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And it seems to be a global darkness, but of course, doesn't it? This event had an effect on the whole world. And now Jesus was silent for these 3 hours. And suddenly he cried out of the darkness the words that he spoke right here at the beginning of Psalm 22 with the first sentence, the fourth statement, which was recorded also in Matthew 27:46, and also recorded in Mark 15:34. But here and now we are looking at something here that is so sacred, and it is something that is hard for all of us, to human beings, to even fathom. This is a holy subject and one that has such an impact on all of our lives. And it is so significant that when we look into it, because like I said, if we get a better understanding of what Jesus went through for us, it will only give us a greater appreciation for him, and a hope, and I hope, it'll give us a greater desire to serve him. And when Jesus cried out these words, my God, why have thou forsaken me? They are not the delusions of a man in pain. No, his faith was not failing him. They were the words of a man who was actually forsaken by God for a time, and he is just stating the truth of the situation. Now, we also must notice that it was not the way that God normally deals with his own. This is not how he deals with you. Because when we face life's hardest moments, when we are the children, we go through the valleys and the storms, and when we go through the calamities and the hardships, it is actually then that the Lord will reveal himself to us. And in such a special way and a tender way to reassure us in our hour of need. many examples of that. It's like what he did with the three Hebrews, with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when they were thrown in the fiery furnace, and the king correctly observed it when he said, I threw three in the furnace, yet I see a fourth, who is likened unto the Son of God. How did he know what the Son of God looked like? Listen, we go through the fiery trials of life. There is Jesus walking with us also. Like, do you remember when Stephen in Acts, who was martyred for his faith, as a young life was draining out of him, he saw the vision that they were stoning him to death, and Jesus was standing at the right side of the Father. He saw that. And we see that Jesus was standing because Stephen was the first martyr for Christ in Acts. In the New Testament, and normally Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, we see over and over again, but this time he is standing. The Lord gave him this tremendous peace as he died. And Stephen asked to forgive all of them too, as he died. And the Bible says his face shone like an angel. And of course, we remember the words of Paul, who had some kind of physical affliction, and he asked the Lord to take it away, and the Lord's answer was no. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is shown strongest during moments of weakness. Did you hear that? His strength is shown the most in our moments of weakness, because that's when you really pray. Many times we don't pray when things are going good. We pray when things are going bad. That's how normally God deals with us, and he brings you out of the storm. But he likes it when you're in it, because you're actually talking to him. He says, I am always with you. And it's just like Moses. Moses was a great speaker, and Moses had a speech impediment. He felt weak all the time and depended on the Lord, which made him strong. Because he was weak, he was available and ready to serve. And that's what God wants, not your ability. He wants your availability. You don't have to be great at something. God can use you in your weakness to be stronger than others. But there was something there at the cross that God had to do with the life of his son for this sacrificial death so it would be fulfilled correctly. So we could come back into a relationship that God desired to have with us clear back when it was lost in the Garden of Eden, when the title deed of the earth was handed over to Satan because of Adam's sin. And the universe was watching at Eden. And the universe was watching at Calvary, and it's watching you right now as you make your decisions on what you're making. What do they say? Secret sin is open scandal in heaven. But now we are speaking of this moment in the life of Jesus when the sins of the world were put over upon him. And the scriptures say that he shall bear their iniquities. Another passage just says he made him to be sin for us. Now that's not sinful. That's sin for us. And at this moment when the great gulf separated him, because God is so holy, he cannot tolerate sin. He had to be represented, and we had to be represented by somebody who was unblemished, and only God is unblemished. So now we are looking today and looked at by God, and he sees Jesus in us. He doesn't see you and the sins that you may have committed. He sees Jesus in us and forgives those sins that are in you because you are saved and you have Jesus in us. This is what happens when we get saved. And Jesus never sinned in his entire life. And he's the only person that lived on the face of the earth that literally kept all of God's commandments to a T. He was the only one that never violated the standards of God, that God laid down for us. And it was because he was God. The Son of God was God the Son. And remember, no one can live the Christian life. It's only Jesus in us that lives it. The Bible says, amen. The Bible says, he who had known no sin, who was so perfect and so pure, he had taken on upon himself, because he had the DNA of God. The Father was in him. All of the impurity and imperfection of this wretched, vile sin that this world had to offer, and he was turned over to Satan to do just that. And so we must thank God for making himself to become a man, to make on your outline the bridge between us and holiness. But to be forsaken of God was more of a source of anguish to Jesus than anything else. And that was the only time that God did not help him. And it was because Jesus had to die. He had to die. And there he bore it all for us. And he was clear-minded. And even to the very end, he had to bore this. And even through intense pain and tremendous loss of blood and insatiable thirst and open mockery of those that are around him, he endured all this in silence. He just blessed people as he was going through it. But when it came to being forsaken by God because of the one-on-one that they had, it was more than he could bear. And it wasn't Peter, why have you forsaken me? No. It wasn't Judas, why have you forsaken me? No. It was Father. But it was because that the Father and the Son had a union that was so close, and yet this had to happen. Well, why? Because if it had not have been, never happened, there would have never been a way that you and I could have come into this relationship that God has for us. He gave his only begotten Son. And it was so that we could receive this Spirit, so God will see him in us. So we have this purpose and discernment and hope and all its power to serve him, which brings joy that he continually gives us and stuff when we do that. But now at this moment where the sin of the world was poured out on Jesus is where the Holy Father had to turn his face, like the song that we just sang today. How deep the Father's love. It was a great love. He had to turn his face from Jesus and let him enter death so Satan's wrath could continue to be poured out on God's dear Son. And you need to understand it's because Satan still controlled death at that point. He controlled death. And you see, there are captives in Hades. And they are not going to be released because Jesus didn't have the keys until he won this war. And they are going to be there until Jesus Christ ascends after that 3 days. People were stuck there from the Old Testament, but the scriptures say that the punishment of peace had to be poured out on him. And it says, by his stripes we are healed. Look at what our Christmas cards say in Isaiah 53, 5 and 6. It says this. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we were healed. All like sheep have gone astray, and you know we have. We have turned every one to his own way, leaning on our own understanding, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. So there at the cross, Jesus voluntarily bore all of this for us. He could have come down, but he did not because of his love for you and me. Let's look at what it says in verse 6 in Psalm 22. Here Jesus says this, I am a worm and not a man. Now that is an interesting statement, isn't it? Now for those who have taken time to memorize all the great I am statements, here's another one to add to the list. He said, I am the bread of life. He said, I am the resurrection of life. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. And here's a new one. I am a worm and no man. NIV says, not a man. Well, why did he use expression like that? Because clearly a worm is one of the lowest of God's creatures. But yet Jesus compared himself to a worm at this point. Well, why? Well, here's one thing. The worm back in this culture is used with crimson crocus flowers where the color scarlet was obtained to color the robes of kings. That was the color of kings. They needed that worm to do it. And the way they made this royal dye was that the worm had to be crushed. So Jesus said, I am a worm. I have to be crushed because through his crushing and through his pain and through his death is that we were made royalty. And now I am Sir Daniel.
Yes.
Crushing the worm makes kings. And did you know that you are royalty too?
Yes.
The Bible says that we, meaning the saints, are a royal priesthood, a holy generation, a peculiar people, which means set apart. We were set apart to show praises to God for what he's done. It makes me think of when Moses was supposed to lead the Israelites out to the desert so they could worship and praise God. That was the reason he had to tell the king, I want you to let my people go so we can go out in the desert so we can worship God. And that was the reason he made us royalty. He wanted to have a people that would worship God. That's what we were made for, to worship God. That's why we don't want to forsake the assembling of us coming together, so we can be together to worship God. God likes worship. He wants praise. Judah means praise. And we were made to praise God. And then when we praise God, he blesses us. And when we do that, and we obey him, we have joy, which makes us want to serve him. He has made us royalty. And once we're covered with his blood, like all who believe in him, all, we shall be clothed in white. White is a sign of purity. That is the wedding garments. That's like the wedding feast. That's where we're going to when we go to heaven. The wedding feast of the Lamb. We're clothed in white. White is the color of the wedding garments. And we'll be called sons and daughters of the King. That's why you're my brothers and sisters in Christ. And ultimately, we become the bride of Christ. You know we're described as the bride of Christ. And we're getting ready for the wedding feast of the Lamb. And on your outline, we'll be considered righteous because of it. Not because of what we did, but because of what he did. And all because of what our high priest did when he sacrificed himself on the cross. It was so important that he did. God could have sent 1,000 angels to keep him from going to the cross. But Jesus had to go out of his way and do everything he could to go to the cross. Because of that, Jesus lived in us today. And that is why he is crushed like a worm. Jesus gave up, on your outline, his privileges and his rights, but not his deity and holiness. He gave up his privilege that deity brings and humbled himself to die in such a way, and just so we might come into union with him. He needed to do this to build this great people. Look what it says in Psalm 22, verses 7 and 8. It says this, all that they see me at laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip and they shake the head, saying, he trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. So it says, all that see me will ridicule me. And what an accurate description of what that was at Calvary. In fact, they are the very words that are used here. Look at in Matthew, don't change her. Don't go there. Matthew 27, 42, it says, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and then we'll believe in him. So it tells us at the foot of the cross, the people cried out that he trusted God, let him deliver him. If we will have him then, for he's the one that said he was the Son of God. And they used the exact wording that David said they would say in Psalm 22 as his enemies mocked him 1,000 years before the crucifixion. How do you know the Bible's right? Because it is. And we have proof of it over and over. Psalm 22 begins with a cry of despair, going down, down, down. And then suddenly, there's an upturn. We're at verse 22, where we stop. And Jesus is saying from the cross, I will praise you. What happened to make such a change? It was finished. He bore the sin of the world, and it changed everything. He had beaten Satan by dying on the cross. Satan played right into God's hands, and he ended up killing Jesus, and it was exactly what God planned. He had become the ultimate sacrifice, unblemished lamb who was able to withstand all of the worst that the world has to offer, so that the battle could be won at Calvary. And anything we go through can't be as great and big as painful as what Jesus went through. So that battle could be won at Calvary. And the title deed to the earth was bought back. Man, isn't that good news that the earth now again belongs to the Lord? Now we're waiting around for 2,000 years for him to take possession of it. the Lord's already won the battle. We always say, well, if he won the battle, how come I'm going through all this trouble and stuff? God allows it. So you know the plan. He's given you the story, the love letter from God. But what are you going to do about it? Are you going to believe in God or not? You know how many people won't? We know of some situations right now where they're trying to convince the people that Jesus is real in this plan, but they don't want to hear. They don't believe it. No, I've went through too many bad things. God can't forgive me. No, I can't believe Jesus is not real because I see this 10-year-old that's dying of cancer. I don't believe Jesus is real because there's going to be a war. I can't believe that Jesus is real because we have all these problems and everything. Those problems are caused by sin. If everybody was saved, there would be no problems then.
That's right. Amen.
But they're not, because there's just people that won't be saved. Also, that is why we are able to receive the Holy Spirit, which directs us now and guides us as well as he holds us up when we are down. And you see, God gives us joy and purpose from his Spirit, who is the witness and who is what his truth is, tells us what truth is. And he helps us to further our relationship with him. And he gives us the direction for our lives and our souls. And he convicts us and keeps us on the right path. And he came to convict us, to show us when we're going wrong. He reveals to us what righteousness is. And you see, it's the Spirit's job. And he bought us back to give us this Spirit in our life so we would know.
Amen.
Praise God. You know, there's a story about this little boy and his boat. Once there was a little boy. And he built himself a boat, and he would play with this boat in the bathtub. And he just loved this little boat. Well, one day when the weather was really nice outside, they went to the river. And the little boy began to play with the boat. And while it was in the water, he had it tied to a string. But in time, a wind came up, and it blew so hard that the boat broke away from his string. And the boat got away from him, and it floated down the river until it was out of sight. Well, a couple days later, the little boy went to the secondhand store. And there he saw his very own little boat in the store. And he asked the man, how much is this little boat? And the guy said, $2. So the boy went home and he got his piggy bank and he broke it. And he went back to the store and he bought this boat back. And after he got it, he said, all right, now you're mine. I made you and I just bought you back, and now you'll be mine for good. It makes me think of how the Lord feels about us. He made us, but he gave us free will so we would choose him. We got lost. And so God sent Jesus to buy us back. And because he paid such a high price with all of the horrible suffering and the giving of his very own life, that he made it so he could never lose us again by his Spirit on the condition of if we would want to be with him. That's the condition. Do you want him? You can have him. If you don't want him, he doesn't want you. He wants you, but he won't take you and secure you for good. You have to get saved. You have to say, Lord, I want you. And the difference is that the Lord doesn't take anybody that doesn't want to be with him. And that's why we see a lost world here, because he doesn't want anybody that doesn't want to be with him. And the Bible says there is no rest for the wicked. And you can see that. And the heart of mankind is wicked, and we are lost without him. It's like what Augustine said, you are restless always until you find your rest in the Lord. And that is the desire of God, that we would return to him and find rest in trusting him. For he loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son for you and for me. And you know, the Bible says that we're guaranteed on your outline to have refuge in him and peace in him. And this is what we talked about so many weeks. It's all about his grace. So as we go back to Psalm 22, starting with those words, my God, why have you forsaken me in sadness? It ends up with the words in Psalm 22, verse 31, when it says this. Psalm 22, 31, it says, they shall come, and they shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. Did you hear that? They will come and declare his righteousness. They will declare his righteousness to a people who will be born. born again. Hallelujah. It's because he has done this. And it's true. We have been born again, and now Jesus lives in us. And we are the light of the world because he is the light and he is in us now. It says, if we will be a great people, we are a beacon of light to the world. And the Lord says he will not do the tribulation until he takes the light out of the world. Are you the light? Hallelujah. In the phrase, he has done this, in 31 we saw, he hath done this. He has done this. It's interesting because in Hebrew it is translated, he finished it. And what did Jesus cry out at the cross in the Gospels with this sixth statement? I have another sermon I talk about the seven statements of Christ. It is finished. Remember, I thirst was the fifth one, but here it is finished. Number six, the number for man. It is finished for man to be bought and back. Number seven is, I commend my hand into your spirit. It's God's number. I commend myself into your spirit, Lord. But right now, see, the six is, it is finished. And it's the Greek word that means it is completed. It is made an end of. It is done. And so the psalm begins with one word that Jesus uttered from the cross, and it ends up with another word that he says, it is finished. Psalm 22 says, he hath done this. He did it for us. And so we come today and we say, Lord, I am so thankful. I want to honor you. And this is why we're going to receive communion today. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. So when we come to the table, we say, Lord, I want to express my praise and my thanksgiving to you for all that you have done for me. But before we start communion, I want to read what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 29, which is the typical communion passage that you have heard so many times. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed and took bread. How do you feel like celebrating the Lord's Supper when you know somebody's going to turn you in? Judas left. And when he said, had given thanks, he broke it and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. This has to do with our suffering. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. We now have grace. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. And I want to ask you, have you done what the Lord has asked you to do? Have you examined yourself? Have you been saved? Have you been baptized? The Lord commanded it. You don't have to be baptized to be saved. The thief on the cross wasn't baptized. But if you're going to carry on in the Lord's family and you are alive and not stuck on a cross hanging there, you should do the first commandment that the Lord has given you. We call it a believer's baptism. After you believe, you do this so you can do it in public to show the world that you're a believer in Christ, because he died publicly for you. He wants you to show the world that you publicly believe, and that baptism shows his death and resurrection. It resembles that. No powerful significance other than the fact that you obey him, and obedience brings joy, and obedience lets you grow in the Lord. Now, there's three things that jump out from the text that we should remember as we come to the communion table. On your outline, we do it, number one, to look back. Because Jesus told us to do it in remembrance of him. The broken bread has stripes on it, symbolizing the unleavened bread, which is his sinless body. Yeast represents sin. It gets in there, it spreads all around, puffs up. And this is what yeast represents, sin. So it's a sinless body. That's why it's unleavened bread. And it's a reminder of what Jesus went through with his body whipped and beaten and abused. The bread is his broken, on your outline, body. So the bread is his broken body. Now remember, people in those days would break bread. The breaking of it represents his broken body. And it says, by his wounds we were healed. Look what it says back in that Christmas card again. Isaiah 53 verse 5. It says, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we were healed. Look what it says in 1 Peter 2:24. It says this, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree. The tree, of course, is what they called the crosses up there. They called them trees. That we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. So we remember the body. Now the cup reminds us of, on your outline, the blood that was shed from the cross at Calvary. And we do it to remember his redeeming blood. Remember, Jesus presents his blood before the Father in heaven at the altar. And that is how he is interceding for us constantly. Satan is spending his time accusing you. Go, look at, they lied. They're not worthy. Oh, look what they did. They cheated. Look what they did. They drank. Look what they did. They did this or that or whatever and stuff. And Jesus is there. Wait a minute. They're with me. They are covered in the blood. And here's the blood at the altar. And that was the blood that was shed at the cross at Calvary. And we do it to remember that. So he presents that blood up there. You know, the world drinks on your outline to forget, but the Christian drinks to remember. We are to remember what the Lord did. So when we are tempted to doubt God's love for us because of our failures during this week, this command of the Lord causes us to remember, to come back to the cross of Christ, because we now belong to him. And no matter what we do, we are forgiven, providing we don't live in that sin. Provided that we ask for forgiveness for it, we are forgiven when we ask for forgiveness. And we must remember this tangible demonstration of love for each and every one of us. And so we remember that as number one. Now, number two, we should look ahead. We need to look ahead. Verse 26 says, we should do this until the Lord comes again. So that's why we repeatedly take communion, so we can sit and remember what the Lord has done for us. And remember how thankful we are that the Lord has done this for us. We give praises to the Lord for what he's done for us. And we do it together as fellowship, because there's nothing that Christ loves more than the church. The church, not this building, but the believers that are unified together in worshiping him. He loves his people more than anything. He did it all for his people so we could all be together. This is the closest thing to what heaven is like. We'll be all together worshiping the Lord in heaven. And then he will be giving us tasks to do throughout the millennium and through all eternity. But we will come together in praise. It even says during the millennium, if we don't go to Jerusalem and praise him and worship with him, he won't bring rain to the land that he gives you when you're getting your portion of land to take care of in the millennium. How good you are, how faithful you are in this testing period here on this earth is what you will receive in your rewards when you go to heaven. What you'll be kings reigning over when you're in heaven. That's why we're important, by that we obey the Lord here. It's not about this life. This life is going to be over pretty soon. Everybody I've ever been with that have died said, this life is so short. I wish I would have done this and this and this and this. Because it's short, but it's all about later. That's what it's all about. Verse 26 says, we should do it until the Lord comes again. Now, the first time Jesus came and he arrived to this earth as a suffering servant, the next time he comes, he's going to come as a conquering king. Yes. On your outline. And just as he fulfilled the promises of his first coming, he will fulfill all the promises pertaining to his second coming. And we should be looking ahead to that day. Number three, we should look within. You know, some people tell us that we should look within for our answers, but that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says that we should look within to see what the problems are on your outline and confess them as sin to God. And here we are told, let a man examine himself. We confess them so we can be forgiven of them. If you do not confess them, you will not be forgiven of them. So as I come to the table, I want to look inside and say, Lord, if there's something in my life that isn't right, if there's something that I've been doing that I have done that's not pleasing to you, I ask you to reveal that to me. And just like the psalmist says, search me, O God, try my thoughts and know my ways. See if there's any wicked way in me. And you see, essentially, the psalmist was saying, Lord, I ask you to show me what is not right so I can bring it to the foot of the cross and ask for your forgiveness. But listen, it's so important that when we come to this table, that we come as believers. It is really an unwise thing, to say the least, for a non-believer to come to the table and participate. And by that, I mean someone who has not put their faith and trust in Christ as their Savior and Lord, because as a non-believer, to come to this table and to take of these elements, and not something that's going to bring you closer to God, but in a sense, it will bring judgment on them. Because it's a most almost like mockery to remember what he did and not accept him in your life. You don't want to do that. If you're joining us here today and you're not sure that Christ is living in your heart, you don't know what it is to say, Jesus is my Savior, and to say, I know that he lives inside of me. You need to do that. And we're going to have a word of prayer right now so you can do that. And we're going to do that right now before we have communion. You know, there's a difference in believing in him and trusting in him. Because remember, the devil believes in him and shudders. So that's not enough. You need to trust him. So how do you believe in him? Do you examine yourselves? We need to have faith. Right now, I'm going to invite everybody that has never put their faith in Christ to do it now. And you believers can join in also as we say this. If you've never asked Jesus to forgive your sins and become your Lord and Savior, I'm asking you to pray right now. And I want you to repeat after me in this prayer. Let's bow our heads right now and let's pray. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I'm sorry for that today. I turn from it. And I turn to you in faith. I ask you to become my Savior, my Lord, my God. And I want you to follow, I want to follow you this day as your disciple. So fill me up, Lord. Fill me with your Spirit. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I now put my faith and trust in you from this time forward. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Right now, can we have the ushers come forward? We're going to pass out the emblems, and we're going to have communion right now. We're going to sing right now, oh, the deep love of Jesus. Let's sing. Let's sing.
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. Vast and measure, boundless and free, rolling as a mighty ocean in his fullness over me. Underneath
Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come together and do this symbolic thing that we do, Lord, as we reminisce and think about what you've done for us, what you have done, what you're doing, and what you're going to do, Lord. We thank you for the bread about the broken body, which pertains to sickness that we have, which pertains to afflictions that we have, which pertains to the suffering that we go through, which pertains to all the things that we have to endure to go ahead and obey you, Lord, and be obedient to your word. Lord, we just thank you for this bread to help us remember these trials and tribulations that we go through here. And Bill, would you say one for the blood, the New Testament?
Father, we are so thankful that you sent your Son, Lord, that he might take our place, die that cruel death, Lord, shed his blood for the remission of sin. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission according to your word. And we're thankful, Lord, that you took our place. You paid the price. We're redeemed with the precious blood of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And we look forward to the time when we'll drink it and eat with you anew in the kingdom, Lord, when we come.
Thank you, Lord. In this new dispensation of grace, we only need to come to you and ask for forgiveness. What a wonderful blessing we have that you've given us through this new time of grace. Let's take the emblems. Praise the Lord. We're so blessed to be in the family of God. Let's sing it one more time, though.
Oh, the deep, deep love.
Stand together with me. I will dismiss you today. I'm thankful you were here for this service today. Right now we're going to sing one last song called Praise the Name of Jesus. That's what we do. He made a people to praise his name. Hallelujah. Let's sing together. Praise the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
thankful to be a part of this body. We're so thankful for the solutions that you've given us to understand why we go through trials and to help us through every one of them, Lord. Help us to create a boldness in our life to tell others about what it means. Help us to have an answer for every man that asks us why we go to church or why we believe in this Lord stuff. Help us to get the right answers for the people so they understand what we're doing here, Lord. That you made a way for everyone who would believe, but it's so hard to get people to believe. And you are counting on us, we know, to let them know what it's all about. So please, Lord, encourage these people to be a light to the world, a beacon of light for all, Lord, that see us. We thank you again, Lord. Bless these people really good. Let them have a great day today, Lord. Let them have a blessed week and protect them, guide them, and guard them. Teach them to pray to you before they make decisions, Lord. We've learned that and stuff. So, Lord, I pray that you bless each and every person real good. And we thank you again, Lord, for everything you're doing. We ask for all of these things, Lord, in your precious name. We pray, Lord, in Jesus' name. And the church said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Go with God today and have a great day today. Tell somebody you love the Lord.
I love the Lord.
Okay.
I love the Lord.
That's a good idea.